kingdom is yours. Rejoice, you jaded and torn, both sinner and saint. The kingdom is yours. Oh, to you religious teachers, rich and worshiping your mouth. Oh, to you who use his name to justify the souls you took.
Well, good morning, St. Andrews.
Good morning.
All right. My name's Craig Santos. I'm the deacon at church. And for those of us who are also viewing us live stream, welcome to our Sunday service. It's a beautiful day. But I do want to thank you all for braving the cold, wet, dreary weather to join us in worship today, and that really says something about you. My next thing, of course, is the connection card. So if you have anyone you want us to pray for, or anything you may need, if you want to talk to the pastor, Sorry, Pastor Brian. Fill it out, and we'll get back to you. Thank you. So we're going to do our mission statement. Please rise. We are St. Andrew's Lutheran Church, inspiring our community. We do this by developing authentic relationships, setting aside ourselves to meet people where they are at. If you would please join me in reading our theme verse today from 1 Corinthians. I have become all things to all people, that by all means I might save some. I do it all for the sake of the gospel, that I may share with them its blessings. We worship today in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Please be seated.
Actually, we're going to let you stay standing. Sorry, Craig.
Oh.
Because we're going to sing.
Am I a little ahead?
We need to stay awake. Or maybe get awake. So let's sing together.
Thank you.
Jerusalem. He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. Great is our Lord and mighty in power. His understanding has no limit. Sing to the Lord with grateful praise. He covers the sky with clouds. He provides food for the cattle and for the young ravens when they call. The Lord delights in those who fear him.
Savior, he
Please be seated.
The first reading is from 1 Corinthians 9, verses 16 to 27. For if I preach the gospel, that gives me no ground for boasting. For necessity is laid upon me. Woe to me if I do not preach the gospel. For if I do this of my own will, I have a reward. But if not of my own will, I am still entrusted with a stewardship. What then is my reward? That is my preaching. I may present the gospel free of charge, so as to not make full use of my light in the gospel. For though I am free from all, I have made myself a servant to all, that I may win more of them. To the Jews, I become a Jew in order to win Jews. To those under the law, I became as one under the law, though not being myself under the law, that I might win those under the law. To those outside the law, I became as one outside the law, not being outside the law of God, but under the law of Christ, that I might win those outside the law. To the weak, I became weak, that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all people, that by all means I might save some. I do it all for the sake of the gospel, that I may share with them in the blessings. Do you know that in the race, all the winners run, but only one receives the prize? So run that you may obtain it. Every athlete exercises self-control in all things. They do it to receive a perishable wreath, but we are imperishable. So I do not run aimlessly. I do not box as one beating the air, but I discipline my body and keep it under control, lest after preaching to others, I myself should be disqualified. This is the word of the Lord.
Please rise for the Alleluia and the reading of the Holy Gospel. Alleluia, these things are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God. Alleluia.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the first chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
And immediately he left the synagogue and entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now, Simon's mother-in-law lay ill with a fever. And immediately they told him about her. And he came in and took her by the hand and lifted her up. And the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sundown, they brought to him all who were sick and oppressed by demons. And the whole city was gathered together at the door. And he healed many who were sick with various diseases and casted out many demons. And he would not permit the demons to speak, because they knew him. And rising very early in the morning, while it was still dark, he departed and went out to a desolate place, and there he prayed. And Simon and those who were with him searched for him, and they found him and said to him, "Everyone is looking for you." And he said to him, "Let us go to the next towns, that I may preach there also, for that is why I came out." And he went throughout all Galilee, preaching in their synagogues and casting out demons. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
In the name of Jesus, amen. Our text for this fifth Sunday after Epiphany is from 1 Corinthians 9. We heard it read, "I have become all things to all people, that by all means I might save some." Amen. You may be seated. We open up today with St. Paul's continuation on what it looks like for a Christian to live their life with others in mind. Last week, we heard about how Jesus calls us to lay down our rights for the sake of others. In 1 Corinthians chapter 9, here there's still more of the same. But unlike 7 days ago, St. Paul isn't talking about our relationship with other Christians. Today, his focus and our focus is outward, towards the many. But first, humor me, if you will. All the way back when I was in 7th grade, I had a fellow student, a girl, of course, tell me something that shines a light into how you, how I, and how most of our world acts. She told me, the heart wants what the heart wants. Now, that is probably one of the most devastating things for a 13-year-old boy to hear, but it shows us something else. Often, we are told to be our authentic selves. In fact, this thinking is championed by influencers, celebrities, and the like. Moment by moment, we are tasked with being true to ourselves. So much so is this deemed to be important that other people need to take heed lest they interact with you, get in the way of our one true holy quest, self-realization. And this way of thinking is found even within the body of Christ. We should wear our faith on our sleeves no matter what. You need to accept me for who I am. I'm a Christian. I know the truth. You need to listen to me. And while this in some sense is true, while we are always called to prepare and to be prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you, we are called to do so with gentleness and respect. And while we are called to make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, teaching them everything that our Lord has commanded us to do, there is a point where demanding that people accept us no matter what crosses the line, a line that St. Paul is very clear about, a line that he draws in the sand. For we are all called to share the gospel. Yes, I'm called to lead God's people in worship on Sunday morning, but even more so, just as important, is God's call for all of his people to tell others of him. You and I, the priesthood of all believers, to tell Jesus to our fallen brethren. For Christ not only calls Christ not only calls us by name, he not only calls us to drop everything, he not only calls the weak and the afflicted, but he calls the many to himself. And it is this reason why St. Paul draws a line in the sand. For we are all called to live an authentic faith. A faith, though, that does not do things at the expense of others, even for those outside of Christ. Now, there is a caveat here. When dealing with others, those who are not Christians, what does God's word say through St. Paul? To the Jews, I became as a Jew in order to win Jews. To those under the law, I became as one under the law that I might win those under the law. To those outside the law, I became as one outside the law that I might win those outside the law. To the weak, I became weak that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all people, that by all means, I might save some. St. Paul knows that Jesus calls all people to himself. And because of that, he strives to reach everyone. Jew, Gentile, weak, strong. St. Paul strives to reach the many because Christ calls the many. But he strives to do so not with an attitude of no matter what. Once again, this calling to be all things to all people has a caveat. St. Paul is not saying that you drop everything, abandon your faith, abandon the life Jesus has given us, the morals that are involved in that, in order to bring others like through the side door, so to speak. For St. Paul tells us that he has become all things to all people to save some, but for what reason? I do it all for the sake of the gospel that I may share with them in its blessings. God calls us to suspend our wants. I really think we sinfully have a need to be authentic and controlling towards the people around us. But that does not mean that we accept those things that are sinful, no matter how important they seem to the unbeliever. And to this end, sharing in the innumerable blessings of the gospel, we are called towards the many. For many are called, but few are chosen. And although this may seem like another mystery of God, perhaps, it is in reality that sin so darkens the mind that it is only through a miracle that we are given faith. Through the proclamation of God's word from the lips of his people and in the waters of holy baptism, faith is promised and given by God. And yes, it is a sad thing that those outside of Jesus refuse to hear his word, or they refuse to have it soften their rock-hard hearts. Nevertheless, the word and the spirit, they work when and where they will. And if this makes us uncomfortable, that many are called, few are chosen, it shouldn't. For it is God's job, his vocation to save, not our own. So when questions of why is this person saved and this other person isn't, when these questions are raised, we should flee from them. For we don't know why. All we know is that by God's good and gracious will, we have been saved. We have been called out of the many and been adopted by the Savior. And so living an authentic life, that looks like having an authentic faith, trusting in Jesus, a faith that loves and cares for people, even though they do things that are an abhorrence to God, because we do the same thing. And consequently, these people probably do things that make us feel uncomfortable. But something to note, you and I, we could preach, we could change the hearts of many through lofty speech and good human arguments, calling people to live more moral lives. And I want to be clear about that. What I'm not saying here is that we could preach and do all of these things to call people to Jesus. We can't do that. That is what God calls us to do. But we sometimes try and make people live lives that reflect Christian morality. We could vote even to make recreational drug use illegal, calling people to stop abiding in ungodly things. We could make our country's laws reflect a biblical view of marriage and even what it means for a man to be a man, a woman to be a woman. And while reflecting God's truth in all of these different topics, while it's so important, once again, we don't accept or champion sinful things that people do. Even if all of these things changed, if people stopped doing these things, no one would be closer to faith. For God's word is clear. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Rather than overemphasizing the moral lives that Jesus calls us to live, when interacting with those outside of the faith, perhaps Christ is calling us to love them in a way that first and foremost draws them closer to him. A love that pulls them out of the many and into the fold of the good shepherd. And yes, I know, God's law condemns so that the gospel lifts us up to newness of life. That is not what I'm saying here. What I am saying is, as Christians, so often we say, hey, stop doing that. God doesn't want you to do that. That's true. But rather than overemphasizing and focusing on the actions of people, what we should be doing is focusing on giving them God's word, law, and gospel, so that Jesus can change their heart. As Christians, we, thanks be to God, we understand the most blessed gift of all, Christ Jesus, our Lord and God, who died and rose and is coming again for us. This is the truth that is sweeter than honey, and it's a treasure that is worth more than all of the riches that the world could conjure up. But I think that we understand this blessed truth, the faith that Jesus has given us, we understand it more when we share it with people who aren't anything like us. And as we come to the end of the season of Epiphany, God showing us his loving and caring work by sending us Jesus to preach, to live, to be sacrificed for us, what exactly would it look like for us to share the faith here at St. Andrew's? What would sharing Jesus with those in our community here in Stockton look like? That's something that Pastor Ron is trying to help us out along and to understand our community a bit more, to understand ourselves as well. For Jesus has done, is doing, and will continue to do amazing things here at St. Andrew's. All the ministries that we have, they help us reach others in our community, in the faith. And Jesus also uses these ministries to lift us up, to strengthen us when our faith falters. And yet all of these things, they show us that Jesus calls the many, Even in our gospel reading, the disciples say, "Everyone's looking for you, Jesus." And although St. Paul's message can be understood as a call to action, which I suppose it is Jesus doing the work. He has called you out of the many and into his flock, a blessing that, as members of God's family, we often perhaps take for granted. But this is precisely what the good news for Christ is for the many, and that includes you. For some, authentic Christianity feels like the gospel is only for people who are outside of the church. Once you become a Christian, God's word is full of commands and marching orders. And while sacred scripture is full of God's law, a way to orient our lives and help us love and care for our neighbor, it is also full of the life-giving, faith-granting, faith-strengthening gospel that Christ calls the many to himself, that he has called you and chosen you. Even as the Lord himself speaks through the prophet Isaiah, "Fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine." It is this truth, a truth that we live in and we live out of daily, that calls us to be gracious and gentle with those who would never set foot within these four walls. For we know and we believe that God performed a miracle claiming us as his children. And it may not seem like a huge miracle, but it truly is. The fact that God softened our sinful, hardened hearts and brought us into his family. And if we know that God performed a miracle doing that, what is stopping him from doing the same with the many? Amen. I mean, now the peace that surpasses all understanding, keep and guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. I ask the congregation to please rise. We continue by professing our faith, by professing the Apostles' Creed, the faith of both the church here on earth and in heaven. I ask, in whom do you believe? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the holy Christian church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. I will invite Bobby and Laura up, but just wait, like 2 minutes, Bobby, because our kids are hanging out in the narthex. Jesus told his disciples, "My peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you," and so we share the peace of God with one another.
have a seat. We're going to hear from Bobby. Have a seat.
Sit.
Yeah, you sit too.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Probably everybody in here knows me, but just in case, Bobby Moore, my wife Laura, I hope everybody knows Rahab. I am now Rahab's top dog. The duel's bailed to the Great White North, leaving it to me. So, honestly, just a couple minutes with the duel's departure and other people moving around and schedule availabilities, basically we're just looking for people. We're looking, actively recruiting for Team Rahab. Both ministry partners, which are the people that will not be holding the leash, that are helping out, greeting people, talking to people, praying with people, as we do our visitations or our deployments, and also for handlers, which actually do get trained to handle Rahab and talk to people, pray for people, and everything that goes with that. If you have any idea, any thoughts, any inclination that you might be interested in this ministry, it's a great opportunity. It's a wonderful ministry. We are very shorthanded when it comes to Monday through Friday weekday visits. Most of us work, and I know a lot of you do too, but even if that's not of your availability and you can do nights and weekends, especially as ministry partners, talk to us. You don't have to be necessarily a dog person. Pastor Brian can attest to that. He's not really a dog person. But we don't have a cat ministry for him, so he gets us. And he is a ministry partner for us, of course. So see us after church if you're interested. Give me a call, email me, text me. Just want to throw it out there that we do need people. Bonnie Hamilton recently joined our team and will eventually become a handler for us. We've got a few others here. Obviously, Amy's here, and Adam, our future top dog, is here. Got to keep going, man. He probably handles better than I do anymore. So if you're interested, we'll be out there. I've got business cards. Most of you have met Rahab before at this service especially, so come give us a talk. But if you want to know a little bit about what a ministry partner does or a handler does or what that entails, the type of training, it's not 40 hours a week. It's a couple of days a month, one meeting after church on Sunday a month, and a little bit of training here and there. So come talk to me, and we'll see if anybody's interested in joining the team. Thank you.
All right, now let's stand up again and sing together.
We might live in sin.
Please join me in prayer this morning. We are grateful for the rain that you have sent to us. We ask you to keep us all safe in this winter weather from flooding and damage that comes with some of these storms. But continue to fill our lakes with rain and shower snow on our mountains that we will need during the summer to provide for your people. Lord, in your mercy. We ask you to continue to bless the team from the sending place that are in Thailand through Wednesday. Help the seeds of faith that have been planted to grow, and use the experience to draw the team members closer to you. Lord, in your mercy. We read in Scripture and have seen with our own eyes your awesome ability to heal the sick. Many of your people suffer physically and mentally, and we take a moment now to name those on our hearts that need you. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we love our friends and family, and we struggle with mortality. We know where we will be after this life. We'll be amazing in your presence. But we often feel a sense of loss and sadness when our loved ones are no longer with us. Provide comfort and understanding for us as we mourn those that are now with you. Lord, in your mercy. As we watch the news, we see unrest in a number of areas. We ask for your intercession and that you bring peace where there is war. Be with the world's leaders to end the conflicts that rage throughout the world and end the suffering of your people. Lord, in your mercy. Continue to be with St. Andrews as we work through the senior pastor call process. Be with pastors Ron and Brian, our mission and ministry council, and the congregation. Bless the upcoming Know Your Community presentations, and Holy Spirit, help us to hear and give us wisdom to move our ministry here in the right direction. Lord, in your mercy. As we dedicate our courtyard after this service, we reflect on all the ways you continue to bless St. Andrews. Bless all of our ministries here and use them not to glorify us, but to bring praise and glory to you. Lord, in your mercy. As we go forth today from this time of worship, give us opportunities to be a blessing to others throughout this week. Holy Spirit, push us to keep from hiding our light under a bushel, but shining it for all to see. Let it be obvious to others that we are Christians through our actions and by our love, and all of God's people say,
amen. Thank you, Ron. I've got a few announcements to make, so please be seated. So we want everybody, you're all invited, we're going to dedicate and celebrate the new courtyard, and thank you all for your generous contributions toward it. We couldn't have picked a better day to hold it. Now next Sunday, please come at 9:45 or stay after the service for a presentation by our interim pastor, Ron Youngdale, and he'll be sharing detailed information about the needs of our community so we'd be better equipped to choose a new senior pastor. Next Wednesday the 14th, so that's not this Wednesday but the one after, join us at noon or 7 p.m. for our Ash Wednesday service. We'll be starting a Lent series based on the I Am statements and the seven last words of Christ. The series includes a free devotional, and you can sign up for daily email devotions using the QR code, which should be on the screen right behind me, or in your bulletin. Our e-news subscribers have also been emailed a link to download all the devotions. Now, if you do not receive your weekly St. Mary's email update or your monthly newsletter, what did I say? St. Andrew's newsletter, sorry. My father was Catholic. Please mark your connection card and we'll get it to you. Also, one last announcement is the deacons' Bible study has been going very well, and this Wednesday we'll have our fifth rendition series in it. It's been well attended. Thank you all who have attended. We'll have this one, and then we'll have to reschedule for after Easter with all the Wednesday evening events going on. And now, let us give an offering to the Lord.
Please rise for confession. I turned to the Lord and pleaded with him in prayer and fasting. I wore rough sackcloth and sprinkled myself with ashes. I prayed to the Lord my God and confessed, O Lord, you are a great and awesome God. You always fulfill your promises of unfailing love to those who love you and keep your commands. But we have sinned and done wrong. We have rebelled against you and scorned your commands and teachings. We have refused to listen to your servants who spoke your messages to our leaders and ancestors and to all the people of the land. Lord, you are in the right, but our faces are covered with shame, just as you see us now. This is true of us all. We are covered with shame because we have sinned against you. The Lord our God is merciful and forgiving. Even though we have rebelled against him, but we have sinned and are full of wickedness. In view of all of your faithful mercies, Lord, please turn your furious anger away from your people. We do not ask because we deserve mercy, but because you are so merciful. We pause in silent confession to our Lord. O Lord, hear. O Lord, forgive. O Lord, listen and act. For your own sake, O my God, do not delay, for your people bear your name. Almighty God, in his mercy, has sent his Son to die for you, and for his sake, God forgives you all of your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all of your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth, for you have had mercy on those whom you created and sent your only begotten Son into our flesh to bear our sin and be our Savior. With repentant joy, we receive the salvation accomplished for us by the all-availing sacrifice of his body and his blood on the cross. Gathered in the name and in the remembrance of Jesus, we beg you, O Lord, to forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood as he bids us do in his own testament. Gather us together, we pray, from the ends of the earth to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feasts of the Lamb in his kingdom, which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers, deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship, with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament of my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me." Taught by our Lord and trusting in his promises, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always, and also with you. Amen. You may be seated.
Sky. Faithfulness. Come to Jesus, He's of our shame, Lord of our sinful hearts, He is our great Redeemer. Sing to Jesus, honor His name. Sing to Jesus, praise His throne. Now and forever, He is the King of heaven. Sing to Jesus, we are His own. Now and forever, sing for the love our God has shown.
Gracious God and Heavenly Father, you have given us a foretaste of the feast to come and the Holy Supper of your Son's body and blood. Keep us firm in the one true faith throughout our days of pilgrimage, so that on the day of his coming, we may, together with all of your saints, celebrate the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom, which has no end. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Oh,
What's that? Cake. That's right. I'm supposed to remind you guys that right after this service in the fellowship hall, we will be having cake for the dedication of the new courtyard. Also, I want to go over our question of the week. This is an interesting one. Why do the people in our community, the people who are we are called to, look like to Jesus? So what do the people of our community that we are called to look like Jesus? It's a kind of a head scratcher for me. I'll have to think about that one for a bit. But in the meantime, amen. He is coming soon.
Amen. Come, Lord Jesus.
Behold. Behold. Got a little...
Yeah.